Hello students, we frequently come across the term organization, manager, role of manager, etc. In this lecture, we will see what is organization, what is management, what is the responsibility of the manager, etc. We will try to understand their roles and functions. Let us first understand what is organization. Definition: an organization is a group of people who work together to achieve a set of objectives or goals. To understand organization, it is essential to know the fundamental elements of organization. They are coordination, common goal, division of labor, and integration. The owner or board of directors establish an organization with a certain goal in the mind. Basically, they start the business to earn money. Their intention is to serve the customer by providing high-class product or excellent services. It will satisfy the customer. To fulfill this, people are recruited with different responsibilities. Different levels are formed to shoulder the different types of responsibilities as per the level. Organization structure is established. Organization structure defines how tasks are divided, grouped, and coordinated in organizations. Every organization has a structure that clarifies the role that organizational member perform so that everyone understand his responsibilities in the group. From senior level of management to junior level of management, job responsibilities vary. At the beginning of the last century, that is 1916, French engineer Mr. Henri Fayol created the principles of management theory. He is recognized as a founding father of management principles. Based on his experience as a successful director or a mining company, he developed several theories that are still relevant today. At that time, managers had no formal training. However, the increasing complexity of organizations created a need for professional management. The entire business is required to be managed. A person having strong technical knowledge is not sufficient to run the business. Many other activities and responsibilities are also to be shouldered by manager. There are many aspects of business like managing the available funds, legal formalities, labor laws, company laws, managing people, stakeholders, etc. Different skills are required by manager to fulfill all the requirements of the business. In today's session, we will see principles of management, role of manager, functions of manager, and lastly, the skills required by manager to become a successful manager. Let us see the background of principles of management. A French management theorist, Fayol was one of the most influential contributors to modern concept of management. He proposed famous five principles of management. He belongs to classical theory of management. It believed that management is universal human activity that applies equally well to the family as it does to the corporation. Now, principles of management. 1. Division of work. The division of work is the course of task assigned to and completed by a group of workers in order to increase the efficiency. Division of work, which is also known as division of labor, is the breakdown of a job so as to have number of different tasks that make up the whole. This means that for every core job, there can be any number of processes that must occur for the job to be complete. When an individual does the same job repeatedly, he acquires speed and accuracy in performance. In words of Fayol, the worker always on the same post, the manager always concerned with the same matters, acquire an ability, sureness, and accuracy which increases the output. 2. Authority and responsibility. Authority is the right to give orders and obtain obedience, and responsibility is the corollary of authority. If a manager has responsibility of a particular activity, then he should be given authority also to control the activity. 3. Discipline. Employees must obey and respect the rules that govern the organization. Good discipline is the result of effective leadership. This is absolutely necessary. 4. Unity of command. Every employee should receive orders from only one superior or behalf of the superior. If more than one boss is giving instruction, then it will result in chaos. 5. Unity of direction. Each group of organizational activities that have the same objective should be directed by one manager using one plan for achievement of one common goal. 6. Subordination. The interest of any one employee or group of employees should not take precedence over the interest of the organization as a whole. Employees' effort should be in line with the organization's goal. 7. Remuneration. All workers must be paid a fair wage for their services. Otherwise, they get demoralized or demotivated, and it affects the productivity. 8. Centralization. Centralization refers to the degree to which subordinates are involved in decision making. 9. Scalar chain. The line of authority from senior management to junior rank represents the scalar chain. Communications should follow this chain. Reporting structure should be from junior to senior level. 10. Order. The principle is concerned with systematic arrangement of men, machine, material, etc. There should be a specific place for every employee in the organization. 11. Equity. Managers should be kind and fair to their subordinates. Fair and firm is the key for a successful manager. 12. Stability of tenure of personnel. High employee turnover is inefficient. Management should provide orderly personnel planning and ensure that replacements are available to fill vacancies. 13. Initiative. Employees are allowed to give productive suggestions. Do not discourage the juniors from giving new ideas. 14. Group spirit. Promoting team spirit will build harmony and unity within the organization. While Fayol came up with his theories almost a century ago, many of his principles are still represented in contemporary management theories. Similarly, management thinkers like Mr. Mintzberg, Mr. Kuntz, and Mr. O'Donnell also recommended some concepts. So many things a manager has to keep in the mind and skillfully get the quality work done from the employees in the stipulated time span. He has to perform various roles as per the situation. He should be fair but firm while taking the decisions. Any decision he takes should always be in favor of the organization in which he works. He has to guide the people, sometimes act as a mentor. Ability to take decisions quickly, managing various agencies and maintaining good relationship with them, etc. Mr. Mintzberg has come up with 10 types of roles manager has to play. Different roles are required to fit together to make a good manager. Multiple roles are to be performed by manager. For instance, as well as leading your team, you might find yourself resolving a conflict, negotiating new contracts, representing your department at a board meeting, or approving a request for a new computer system. Put it simply, you are constantly switching roles as task, situation and expectations change. Management expert and professor Henry Mintzberg recognized this, and he argued that there are 10 primary roles or behaviors that can be used to categorize a manager different function. We will see these roles and see how you can use your understanding of them to improve your management skills. The roles. Mintzberg published his 10 management roles in his book, Mintzberg on Management Inside Our Strange World of Organization, in 1990. According to Mintzberg, these roles or expectations for a manager behavior fall into three categories: informational, that is managing by information; interpersonal, that is managing through people; and decisional, managing through action. The 10 roles are: 1. Figurehead, that is source of inspiration, person with authority; 2. Leader; 3. Liaison, that is communicating with internal and external contacts; 4. Monitor; 5. Disseminator, that is providing useful information to colleagues; 6. Spokesperson, speaking on behalf of the organization; 7. Entrepreneur; 8. Disturbance handler, that is handling the dispute mediator; 9. Is resource allocator; and lastly, the 10th is negotiator. These 10 roles Mr. Mintzberg has further divided into three categories. 1 is interpersonal, which is inclusive of figurehead, leader and liaison. 2 is informational, which is inclusive of monitor, disseminator and spokesperson. The 3rd is decisional, that is inclusive of entrepreneur, disturbance handler, resource allocator and negotiator. Let us look at each of these 10 managerial roles in greater detail. Interpersonal category. The managerial roles in this category involve providing information and ideas. That is, 1. Figurehead. As a manager, you have social, ceremonial and legal responsibilities. You are expected to be a source of inspiration. People look at you as a person with authority and as a figurehead. 2 is leader. This is where you provide leadership for your team, your department, or perhaps your entire organization. And it is where you manage the performance and responsibilities of everyone in the group. 3 is liaison. Managers must communicate with internal and external contacts. You need to be able to network effectively on behalf of your organization. Informational category. The managerial roles in this category involve processing information. 4th is monitor. In this role, you regularly seek out information related to your organization and industry, looking for relevant changes in the environment. You also monitor your team in terms of both their productivity and their well-being. 5 is a disseminator. This is where you communicate potentially useful information to your colleagues and to your team. 6th is spokesperson. Managers represent and speak for their organization. In this role, you are responsible for transmitting the information about your organization and its goals to the people outside it. 3rd is decisional category. The managerial roles in this category involve using information. 7. Entrepreneur. As a manager, you create and control change within the organization. This means solving problems, generating new ideas and implementing them. 8 is disturbance handler. When an organization or team hits an unexpected roadblock, it is the manager who must take charge. You also need to help mediate disputes within it. 9 is resource allocator. You will also need to determine where organizational resources are best applied. This involves allocating funding as well as assigning the staff and other organizational resources. 10, negotiator. You may be needed to take part in and direct important negotiation within your team, department or organization. After seeing the manager in different roles, let us see what the functions of the manager. Functions of management. Management has been described as a social process involving responsibility for economical and effective planning and regulation of operation of an enterprise in the fulfillment of given purposes. It is a dynamic process consisting of various elements and activities. These activities are different from operative functions like marketing, finance, purchase, etc. Rather, these activities are common to each and every manager, irrespective of his level or the status. Different experts have classified functions of management. According to George and Jerry, there are 4 fundamental functions of management, that is planning, organizing, actuating and controlling. According to Henry Fayol, to manage is to forecast and plan, to organize, to command and to control. Whereas Luther Gulick has given a keyword POSDCORB. Let us see what does it mean. P for planning, O for organizing, S for staffing, D for directing, CO for coordination, R for reporting and B for budgeting. The most widely accepted functions of management are given by Koontz and O'Donnell, that is planning, organizing, staffing, directing and controlling. For a theoretical purpose, it may be convenient to separate the function of management, but practically these functions are overlapping in nature, that is they are highly inseparable. Each function blends into other and each affects the performance of others. 1. Planning. It is the basic function of management. It deals with chalking out a future course of action and deciding in advance the most appropriate course of action for achievement of predetermined goals. According to Koontz, planning is deciding in advance what to do, when to do, and how to do. It bridges the gap from where we are and where we want to be. A plan is a future course of actions. It is an exercise in problem solving and decision making. Planning is determination of courses of action to achieve desired goals. Thus, planning is a systematic thinking about ways and means of accomplishment of predetermined goals. Planning is necessary to ensure proper utilization of human and non-human resources. It is all pervasive. It is an intellectual activity and it also helps in avoiding confusion, uncertainties, risks and wastages, etc. Now, the second principle is organizing. It is the process of bringing together physical, financial and human resources and developing productive relationship amongst them by achievement of organizational goals. According to Henry Fayol, to organize a business is to provide it with everything useful or its functioning, that is raw material, tools, capital and personnel. To organize a business involves determining and providing human and non-human resources to the organizational structure. Organizing as a process involves identification of activities, classification of grouping of activities, assignment of duties, delegation of authority and creation of responsibility, coordinating authority and responsibility relationship. Now, third function is staffing. It is the function of manning and organization structure and keeping it manned. Staffing has assumed greater importance in the recent years due to advancement of technology, increase in size of business, complexity of human behavior, etc. The main purpose of staffing is to put right man on right job, that is, square pegs in square holes and round pegs in round holes. According to Coons and O'Donnell, managerial function of staffing involves manning the organization structure through proper and effective selection, appraisal and development of personnel to fill the roles designed in the structure. Staffing involves manpower planning, estimating manpower in terms of searching, choose the person and giving the right place, recruitment, selection and placement, retreatment and removal, training and development, remuneration, performance appraisal, promotion and transfer. These are the functions. Now, the fourth is directing. It is the part of managerial function which actuates the organizational method to work efficiently for achievement of organizational purposes. It is considered life spark of the enterprise which sets it in motion, the action of people, because planning, organizing and staffing are the mere preparation for doing the work. Direction is that interpersonal aspect of management which deals directly with influencing, guiding, supervising, motivating subordinate for the achievement of organizational goals. Direction has elements like supervision, motivation, leadership and communication. Supervision implies overseeing the work of subordinates by their superior. It is the act of watching and directing work and workers. Motivation, it means inspiring, stimulating or encouraging the subordinates with zeal to work. Positive, negative, monetary, non-monetary incentives may be used for this purpose. Leadership may be defined as the process by which manager guides and influences the work of subordinates in desired direction. Communication is the process of passing information, experience, opinion, etc. from one person to another. It is a bridge of understanding. Fifth is controlling. It implies measurement of accomplishment against the standard and correction of deviation, if any, to ensure achievement of organizational goals. The purpose of controlling is to ensure that everything occurs in conformities with the standards. An efficient system of control helps to predict deviations before they actually occur. According to Theo Hemmann, controlling is the process of checking whether or not proper progress is being made towards the objective and goals and acting if necessary to correct any deviation. According to Coons and O'Donnell, controlling is the measurement and correction of performance activities of subordinates in order to make sure that the enterprise objectives and plans desired to obtain them as being accomplished. Therefore, controlling has steps like establishment of standards performance, measurement of actual performance, comparison of actual performance with the standards and finding out deviation, if any, finding out the deviation with reasons, and lastly, corrective action. Top managers do considerably more planning, organizing and controlling than do managers at any other level. However, they do much less leading. Most of the leading is done by the first line managers. The amount of planning, organizing and controlling decreases down the hierarchy of management. Leading increases as you move down the hierarchy of management. Now, lastly, let us discuss the skills required by the managers. Management skills. Regardless of organizational level, all managers must have 5 critical skills: technical skills, interpersonal skills, conceptual skills, diagnostic skill, and political skill. Technical skill. Technical skill involves understanding and demonstrating proficiency in a particular workplace activity. Technical skills are things such as using a computer word processing program, creating a budget, operating a piece of machinery, or preparing a presentation. The technical skills used will differ in each level of management. First level managers may engage in the actual operation of the organization. They need to have an understanding of how production and service occur in the organization in order to direct and evaluate line employees. Additionally, first line managers need skill in scheduling workers and preparing budgets. Middle managers use more technical skills related to planning and organizing. And top managers need to have skills to understand the complex financial working of the organization. Interpersonal skill. Interpersonal skill involves human relations or manager's ability to interact effectively with organizational members. Communication is a critical part of interpersonal skill, and an inability to communicate effectively can prevent career progression for managers. Managers who have excellent technical skill but poor interpersonal skills are unlikely to succeed in their jobs. This skill is critical at all levels of management. Conceptual skill. Conceptual skill is a manager's ability to see the organization as a whole, as a complete entity. It involves understanding how organizational units work together and how the organization fit into its competitive environment. Conceptual skill is crucial for top management, whose ability to see the big picture can have major repercussions on the success of the business. However, conceptual skill is still necessary for middle and supervisory managers, who must use this skill to envision, for example, how work units and teams are best organized. Diagnostic skill. Diagnostic skill is used to investigate problems, decide on a remedy, and implement a solution. Diagnostic skill involves other skills like technical, interpersonal, conceptual, and political. For instance, to determine the root of a problem, a manager may need to speak with many organizational members or understand a variety of informational documents. The difference is the use of diagnostic skill across the 3 levels of management is primarily due to the types of problems that must be addressed at each level. For example, first level managers may deal primarily with issues of motivation and discipline, such as determining why a particular employee's performance is flagging and now how to improve it. Middle managers are likely to deal with issues related to larger work units, such as a plant or sales office. For instance, a middle level manager may have to diagnose why sales in a retail location have dipped. Top managers diagnose organization-wide problems and may address issues such as strategic position, the possibility of outsourcing tasks, or opportunities for overseas expansion of a business. Political skill. Political skill involves obtaining power and preventing other employees from taking away one's power. Managers use power to achieve organizational objectives, and this skill can often reach goals with less effort than others who lack political skill. Much like the other skills described, political skill cannot stand alone as a manager's skill. In particular, though, using political skill without appropriate levels of other skills can lead to promoting a manager's own career rather than reaching organizational goals. Managers at all levels require political skills. Managers must avoid others taking control that they should have in their work positions. Top managers may find that they need higher levels of political skill in order to successfully operate in their environments. Interacting with competitors, suppliers, customers, stakeholders, government, and the public may require political skill. So far, we have seen the principles of management, role of management, functions of management, and lastly, skills required for manager. So, for a good and successful manager, these mentioned qualities are required. So, students, I hope you have understood the requirements of a successful manager. Thank you.